Yeah.
Go.
Okay. Let me say a quick prayer and we'll get going. Lord, thank you for clarity in this world that you give us through your word and through the order that we see. As we study how other people are viewing things and whatnot, help us to remember that these things are important for us to know just so we can talk to these people in a coherent manner and so they'll understand your gospel. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Okay, today we're doing a couple broad things. We're going to do them very quickly. I put up here the main questions that we want to be answering or thinking about as we go through this. And does the piece address explicitly or implicitly any of those things? The other thing we're going to look at is whether these things reflect reality or absurdity. Remember, we started this, biblical worldview leads you to reality. And then we have existentialism, nihilistic thought, mysticism, those kinds of things. And when I decided to put what I did on these slides, I basically had to winnow things down to, let's look at modern thought, okay? We will do a brief history of music. That'll take about 10 minutes. And it will be done with a purpose. I'll explain it when we get there. But I want to start with literature. And so we're going to start with modern thought. And so you're probably wondering why this is up here. Is anybody here a Shakespearean actor or actress? Would you like to read this? Let me read it then. I will do this first one. She should have died hereafter. There would have been a time for such a word. Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this pretty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle, life's but a walking shadow, a poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. So, what you guys know about existentialism, you know about some of these other concepts we've talked about, what do you see here? It's kind of amazing.
It kind of fits.
It absolutely fits. And the thought that I had as I was going through things was, you know, people haven't changed since the fall. Mm-hmm. We're fallen people. And I'm sure people have had these thoughts, whether they're existential or nihilistic or all these different thoughts over time. They just weren't endemic to the time period. And this definitely wasn't endemic. He's a Renaissance guy writing during a Reformation period, and still the thought is there. So just be aware, what happens is we've labeled all these philosophies and stuff, and we've identified times when they really took hold in time of a society. So here we see it right there, very clearly, kind of modern thought. Would somebody read this one?
This goodly frame, the earth, seems to me a sterile promontory, this most excellent canopy, the air, look you, this brave o'erhanging firmament, this majestical roof fretted with golden fire. Why, it appears no other thing to me than a foul and pestilent congregation of vapors. What a piece of work is a man, how noble in reason, how infinite in faculty, in form and moving, how express and admirable, in action, how like an angel, in apprehension, how like a god. The beauty of the world, the paragon of animals, and yet, to me, what is this quintessence of dust?
Does that remind you of anything? Does it speak to any of this? What do you see?
It speaks to the nature of man.
Absolutely. Is it biblical?
Psalm 8.
Yeah. Pretty close. It's a little bit below God.
Yeah, was that maybe a little lower than angels?
Yeah. All that is there. How about nature of the universe? Sort of? Kind of?
You probably shoehorn it in there, but no.
Yeah, you're going to shoehorn a little bit during this whole thing.
Just recognize man is made from dust.
True.
Yeah.
I think that the pestilent congregation of vapors is interesting. This whole thing of, it's like you got this universe, this earth, you got this and this, and he's like, one's dust, one's vapors. It's like, it's not a real happy passage, I guess. But it is interesting that a lot of these thoughts that Shakespeare had have become prevalent today. So this next piece, we're now going to leapfrog into the more modern stuff. This next piece is by an author who was an atheist. He likes to parody things. And I think you'll see a little bit of modern thought here. In the beginning, God created the earth, and he looked upon it in his cosmic loneliness. And God said, let us make living creatures out of mud, so the mud can see what we have done. And God created every living creature that now moveth, and one was man. Mud as man alone could speak. God leaned close to mud as man sat up, looked around, and spoke. Man blinked. What is the purpose of all this? He asked politely. Everything must have a purpose, asked God. Certainly, said man. Then I leave it to you to think of one for all of this. And he went away.
Yeah, that's Vonnegut.
That's Vonnegut, but it's of all the definitions I could put up of existentialism, that's perfect. He's making fun of existentialism. Because number one, he brings God into the equation, which the true existentialists would do. And then he kind of throws it in their face.
That's deism too. So
that's what I was thinking.
Deism, which would lead to existentialism.
Exactly, it goes straight there, doesn't it? So, and that's Cats from Cat's Cradle. There's other writings in there, and you know, if you're really offended by something, that you know, you could find more in his writings regarding the Lord or God.
I bet he's not an atheist anymore.
No, and nobody is on the other side of this thing. Okay, this is from The Stranger. Can you read these?
Yes, of course.
Out loud.
Read it. All right. Mammon died today, or yesterday, maybe. I don't know. I got a telegram from the home. Mother deceased. Funeral tomorrow. Faithfully yours. That doesn't mean anything. Maybe it was yesterday. It occurred to me that anyway, one more Sunday was over, that Mammon was buried now, that I was going back to work, and that really nothing had changed. She asked me if I loved her. I told her it didn't really mean anything, but that I didn't think so. She looked sad. But as we were fixing lunch, and for no apparent reason, she laughed in such a way that I kissed her. Looking back on it, I wasn't unhappy. When I was a student, I had lots of ambitions like that. But when I had to give up my studies, I learned very quickly that none of it really mattered.
What are your thoughts? Are these normal ways to behave?
I'm glad I didn't read the book.
This is just the first three chapters. These are just extended quotes. You can go through the whole thing, and it's just amazing. The meaninglessness that he presents. So, anybody read Camus?
Yes.
The Plague is another book that even goes beyond that. So you can see how these things get into literature, they're out there, and you can see pieces of it through different authors. And Catch 22 is another one that has some amazing stuff in it.
Yeah.
The character here is a Yasserian, is a pilot. He's stuck running missions, and they keep moving the bar for him to be able to go home. So he gets to 20 missions, and they move it to 25, and then he gets to 25, and they move to 30, so he just can't get out of it. So anyway, here's the catch, catch 22. You mean there's a catch? Sure, there's a catch, Doc Denica replied. Catch 22. Anyone who wants to get out of combat duty isn't really crazy. There was only one catch, and that was catch 22, which specified that a concern for one's own safety in the face of dangers that were real and immediate was the process of a rational mind. Another pilot, or was crazy and could be grounded. All he had to do was ask, but and as soon as he did, he would no longer be crazy and would have to fly more missions. Or would be crazy to fly more missions and sane if he didn't. But if he was sane and he had to fly them, if he flew them, he was crazy and didn't have to. But if he didn't want to, he was sane and had to. Yassarian was moved very deeply by the absolute simplicity of this clause of catch 22 and let out a respectful whistle. That's some catch, that catch 22 observed. It's the best there is, Doc Denneke agreed. As impressed as Yassarian is with the circular perfection of catch 22, it does nothing to help his situation. If anything, it articulates the helplessness of it. They're not going to send a crazy man out to be killed, are they? Who else will go? So, what are your observations of this? This kind of mentality. Is this reality or absurdity?
Sadly, I think it's reality.
That's because you worked in America, right? Yeah. Does it say anything about the nature of man? Military intelligence?
Says a lot about that.
Yeah.
Talks about bureaucracy in the perfect way.
Yeah. Yes.
I think it does a good job of explaining why there is pain.
Yeah. And we've got some more of that.
Yeah.
I mean, real quick here. You know, it's kind of a reflection of the whole existential absurdity of life kind of thing. And it does it in a funny way. It's a rough book, but it does have some really funny stuff in it. So let's go to the next thing. Would somebody read this? This is a conversation between Yassarian and Lieutenant's wife, who's having a debate with him.
And don't tell me God works in mysterious ways, Yassarian continued, hurtling on over her objection. There's nothing so mysterious about it. He's not working at all. He's playing, or else he's forgotten all about us. Good God, how much reverence can you have for a supreme being who finds it necessary to include such phenomena as phlegm and tooth decay in his divine system of creation? Why in the world did he ever create pain? Pain, Lieutenant Chyskov's wife pounced upon the word victoriously. Pain is a useful symptom. Pain is a warning to us of bodily dangers. But who created the dangers, Yassarian demanded. He laughed caustically. Oh, he was really being charitable when he gave us pain. Why couldn't he have given us a doorbell instead to notify us, or one of his celestial choirs, or a system of blue and red neon tubes right in the middle of each person's forehead? Any jukebox manufacturer worth his salt could have done that. Why couldn't he?
So is there any truth about pain in here?
Well, absolutely. I mean, your doctor will tell you if you have pain, you should maybe say something about it. And yeah. There's no warning sign.
Yeah.
That's a truth.
Yeah, there's a truth.
Well, we can't escape pain no matter how perfect we are.
Yeah. It's not all physical.
C.S. Lewis said pain was a megaphone to arouse a deaf world to God's voice.
Yeah. That's how God gets our attention.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We know something isn't right? Mm-hmm. How about his view of God?
He's using the problem of evil, obviously.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Well, and I have a guy at work, that's Mark, that I'm dealing with. He and I get along great, but he is completely convinced that religion is just made up silliness. And we have some really interesting conversations. But he has a huge, this is the one he always comes back to, is if God truly were perfect and all loving, he wouldn't let children, you know, he goes into the whole, and the fallen world conversation falls on deaf ears, right? Even though it's truth, he has zero desire to hear it because he can't fathom how a loving God would allow a child to get cancer. That's the one he likes to throw at me, usually. Yeah. So.
Well, and this conversation even goes worse. I didn't put it all in. It's the next page, I put a little gap in here, but it's like he really goes off on God, and he's mad at God, but it's kind of like, well, when we read this, you'll see how ridiculous it really is for him to even be mad. So let me go ahead and read this. Yasserin continued his diatribe against God. Stop it, Lieutenant Suskus. Wife screamed suddenly and began beating him ineffectually about the head with both fists. Stop it. What the are you getting so upset about? He asked bewilderedly in a tone of contrite amusement. I thought you didn't believe in God. I don't, she sobbed, bursting violently into tears. But the God I don't believe in is a good God, a just God, a merciful God. He's not the mean and stupid God you make him out to be. Yasserin laughed and turned her arms loose. Let's have a little bit more religious freedom between us, he proposed obligingly. You don't believe in the God you want to, and I won't believe in the God I want to. Is that a deal? They can't, as much as they try, get away from God. In a lot of the existential writing, you will see references to God. And of course, it's not an accurate view of the nature of God, but it's there. And the other thing is, ethics and morality, pain, all these things are wrapped up in their writings, but they have no answers. And so they show us this absurdity and never really get to reality. So that was the big problem, and I think Tyler did a good job of telling us. You can never get to actual reality without God. So anyway, when you read modern literature, you will find these kinds of things through them. Now this is...
Is it a pilot's wife that was not believing God? Because you feel kind of bad for her, because if she doesn't believe in God, who does she pray to keep her husband safe when he's on his sorties?
True. I mean, and that's why, you know, the catch 22 is right. So they want out. They've seen it on. At the end of catch 22, Yasserin's walking through Rome, and it's a shambles, and it's really bad. And he said, now I know how Christ felt when he was walking through the world and seeing what he saw, like a psychiatrist walking through a psych ward or a, you know, whatever. So he kind of, there's like this little section in there where he uses that analogy in the writing. Anyway, it's the last one I want to do on this. Oh, good, we're good on time. This is not Ayn Rand, it's Ian Rand.
Ayn Rand.
Yeah, say it like you're from Arkansas and you'd be good. So this is from a few different pieces. First one from The Fountainhead, self-sacrifice, but it is precisely the self that cannot be and must not be sacrificed. The only two philosophers that she liked, other than herself, were Aristotle and Thomas Aquinas. So it was Aristotle, Aquinas, and Ayn. So you can see her focus on the particulars, right? Achievement of your happiness is the only moral purpose of your life. And that is happiness. And that happiness, not pain or mindless self-indulgence, is the proof of your moral integrity, since it is a proof and the result of your loyalty to the achievement of your values.
That's messed up.
Yeah. Well, definitely has something to say about her view of the basis of morality, right? And ethics. The last part is from Anthem. It said, and now I see the face of God, and I raise this God over the earth, this God whom men have sought since men came into being, this God who will grant them joy and peace and pride. This God is this one word, I. Just completely, you know, iPhone oriented. I don't know. This is
Primary got it.
Yeah, exactly. So here we can see in literature, again, this whole idea of chasing the particulars or chasing the universal, you know, whatever it is, you can see it here. Okay, I got through that in about 15 minutes, which is good because we're going to discuss music more. I'm going to now go through about a 10-minute history of music and listen for the change that happens. It is much like art, which rose to great heights and then started down.
We're talking about Journey and Van Halen, right?
Yeah. Careful your choices here, brother.
Actually, I'll tell you what I did. Well, after we get through music history, I'll explain.
Yeah, go for it.
Okay. So, you can read while things are playing. Oh, no. It's not playing, Alex.
Here, just use the mouse.
Yeah, push it a little bit.
No, here. Some of it won't be so. To me, it is very uncomfortable to listen to. And this, you can see the quotes here by Stravinsky and Leonard Bernstein. about how they regard this, because this is where really music took a turn, okay? Much like the Impressionists and the Post-Impressionists and whatnot, things started going downhill, okay? So, Debussy is another one.
Sitting right there, the conductor with his hands up, and nothing.
Yeah, the guy stands up with a horn.
Dumb thing. That's his thing.
Yeah, so the absurdity that we see happen in art eventually happens in music also.
Well, now, people bought into this dude's silliness.
I know. Now, a lot of the dissonance and fragmentation of music and stuff, it ended up in other places, in jazz and some other places. It didn't end up in country western, sorry, John. But anyway, we can kind of see this downhill slide as people get into these strange philosophies. And if you buy into the philosophy, you might think that's brilliant. If you don't buy into the philosophy, it's absurd. So really, it's either reality or it isn't. And from a biblical standpoint, it's absurd.
Are you saying the country of Western escape from absurdity?
Absolutely. I didn't put anybody, any of those in the next series here.
You're going to do something from our lifetimes?
Is that yes.
The next? Okay.
The next set of songs are all from our lifetimes.
Well played, sir.
Alex knows because he is my technical advisor. He's the guy who put together all the music up so that I can put them on the slides. So I couldn't do that. So kudos, Alex. We didn't put any rap or anything of that nature in. A lot of the lyrics were so abusive and really don't reflect the philosophy, but really more just pure evil, much of it. Thomas sent me a link to an article by Juan Williams at Fox News, who I rarely have any agreement with, but he talks about rap and driller music and its effects in our society and how bad it is. And it might be a good thing to go read. So anyway, as you go through these, we're going to listen to pieces of songs. Some of them I have in multiple pieces. And let's talk about the philosophies and stuff that you see here. Okay.
I did find the one that jumped out at me as Becker is the "Do you find the direction sign on the straight and narrow highway?"
Yeah.
And if you think about the time period as they were coming out of a, if you will, a true Christian nation, and people were starting to really rebel against that as you came out of the 50s and the 60s, mm-hmm. especially in the 70s with disco and everything. That's got, I mean, I'm sure he did it almost probably subconsciously. But there was, he was probably, he or she, whoever wrote this, probably came out of a family that he went to church on Sundays, or she did, and that had to have been in the back of their head when they wrote that line.
I think so. It was written in 69, I believe.
Perfect. Yep. Your husband wrote his problem.
Makes sense. So, you know, just let it shine with you. That's where you're going to get the answer.
Yep.
How about the spinning wheel? I mean,
it's like a merry-go-round. That, yeah.
There's no... Just, there's no destination.
Next 22.
Yeah, exactly. It's the same type of thing.
I just think it sounds like a psychedelic trip here. Like, let it shine within your mind. Show the colors that are real.
I love the horns, though.
Yeah.
One of the things I did, I tried to choose things that have a melody. Because I could go get R.E.M. and I could go get Nirvana and I could go get Metallica. And it's just, it's...
What's wrong
with REO? More toward the end. But you know what? Those aren't the songs that are going to lure us in. It's the songs where there's a bad message in the song, but we like the music.
And
you guys probably know this song. I mean, older people.
So yeah, I remember this playing on
the radio.
Huh?
I know
a
jazz version.
Yeah.
This is
the world. There's no point.
There's no point.
We're just spinning around.
It's like, hey, you got all these bad problems. Just be on the ride.
And it was totally against the establishment.
Yeah.
To your point, I remember this was popular on the radio, and I would ride around in the car and sing along and I had no idea what the words were telling me.
Well, but it sure grabbed your attention. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, next one.
Absurdity to it. It's
very much so.
Yeah.
See some of that modern. How about
the theme is always, you know, what happens when you die, but within that, I think it was a denial of what we know is true.
Well, he's trying to me, he's wanting one side of the equation, but not the other. what's the inference about God or what happens after? He says, swear there ain't no heaven.
Mm-hmm. Right. Because they were dealing with the Vietnam War, and this was the generation that was going to be pretty much included in that conflict. Not the war, it was conflict, police action.
Yes.
And so during that period, I studied the music stuff in school. And during this period, that's when they started. Usually at that age group, you didn't really think about dying. I mean, you don't in your 20s and your late teens. But it was very real to them because they saw what a messed up situation was going on over there, and the draft was still in.
Yeah.
And so I think that generation at that time became very focused on that, and there couldn't possibly be a God because everything was just blowing up in front of them in their future.
We'll see the second half of the song here. And,
you want me to listen to more of that?
There's more of it. And it gets worse. I hate to tell you. But also.
Here I go.
So what is this song? What does this half of the song tell you about it? What does he want?
He wants to go. I mean, there's definitely a fear of what's coming. I mean, you can feel that in the undertone.
But he still wants to do everything he wants to do.
Yeah.
Give me my freedom as long as I be. All I ask is of living is have no chains on me. It's complete. Let's get rid of this. I don't want to do this. And I don't want to acknowledge that.
I don't want to be held accountable if I happen.
Exactly. It's a horrendous song, but it was really popular. It was actually written by a woman from Canada.
Lauren Knight.
That's why we got out of that.
In a serious note, though, it sounds like a black spiritual.
Yeah.
Which are always sinful and upbeat and, you know, born out of hardship and a lack of freedom.
Sure.
And now he's got freedom.
Yeah.
And but he doesn't want to be answerable to God. And
that's right.
For the black community, God was very real because he could deliver them from the oppression they faced.
Makes sense. Okay.
Say, I think life is better when we just heard it on the radio. We had no idea what the lyrics were.
I'm with Steve. That is, I don't know that I've ever caught that. I ain't got no moral at the bad guy.
I know I'm
going, was I singing that?
Yeah.
And I know I was, but that's so interesting.
It's absurdity, isn't it? It's total absurdity. Who was it? Tommy Nelson gave a talk on history of music and did all that. And this is the last thing he ended with. And he said, did we fly high up in the sky like a bird, or did we crash? Mm-hmm. And basically, I think came to the conclusion we crashed.
It's also just kind of aimless. Like, I don't know where it's going. Yeah. You know.
Go.
Yeah.
Look.
Yeah. go with the flow.
It seemed to me that he did have a melody, but
he lied. No, he's a liar too.
They just kind of go around in circles.
I think the song started out as a joke. His one of his buddies and him did a lot of their writing together, and he had this melody, and so they just started throwing this stuff out. That's kind of how it ended up there. So
biggest hits.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh yeah.
listen to the beginning of this.
Now you're getting
personal. We'll now do the national anthem, but you needn't rise. The final curtain. My friend, I'll make it clear.
Sound just like it.
I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, traveled each and every highway.
Credit to anybody?
Him.
Not even the mob? Okay. We'll keep going.
Very frank.
Yes, there were times I guess you knew when I bit off more than I could chew. And with it all, when there was doubt, I
is he convinced yet that it was him?
Yeah.
Old blue eyes.
For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who
what are you thinking?
It's the me generation. Mm-hmm. It's the total me generation.
You'd be so canceled today.
Well, which of our philosophers do you think that he would really connect with?
Ayn Rand.
Ayn Rand. Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
I never picked up on the line and not the words of the one who kneels.
Yeah.
Yeah. It jumped out at me too, Steve.
Mm-hmm. Is that a religious kneeling or is that just in connection to the to say the thing he truly feels rather than feeling like he needs to subjugate himself to anybody?
Well, either way.
Being on
yeah.
Well, it is a difference. We could be offended as Christians or we could just be offended as people.
Well, let me ask you a question. Do you think we're more honest about ourselves for somebody who knows us really well.
Say that again?
Do you think we're more honest about ourselves or somebody who knows us really well?
Is more honest about us, you mean?
Yeah.
Oh, definitely the latter. I guarantee Christy will point out things that I would gloss over without any issue.
Those of us who are married, not I understand that. Yeah,
that ego thing, I married a woman to make sure I kept that in check a little bit.
Let me tell you about the song. Frank Sinatra, I think he was in Vegas or something. He's just sick of the business. And they're talking, and Paul Anka's there, and they're talking. And Anka goes off, and he finds this tune from these two guys in Ireland, I believe it was, or France. It was France. He buys the tune. He writes this song for Sinatra. By the time Sinatra's done with his career, he's sick of the song. He tells his daughter, he says, "This is so self-serving." So to give him some credit, he recognized the thing. But it has a very, it's all about mankind, kind of humanistic message.
Well, this and New York was probably his very biggest hits.
Sure. I think he probably got sick of the song, but had to sing it because it was,
It's interesting, it's opening a couple of lines, it's talking about a national anthem.
That's become
the anthem.
Two
generations.
That's a good point too. Yeah.
Yeah, that was what I was thinking when I heard that. Because at first I'm going, "What's he talking about?" And then I started thinking about it, going, "Yeah."
When he said national anthem, I was thinking Star-Spangled Banner. Then you started listen to the lyrics.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I can point out that Paul Anka was a Canadian.
Love it. Oh boy. Thanks, George. Okay. This is the song that
that's not the Beatles. That's just John Lennon.
That's just John Lennon.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's not the Beatles.
Yeah. He was in the Beatles, so.
Thank you.
definitely absurdity.
Well, yeah. I hate it.
Communal, like just.
Well, that's why I've always thought. I mean, it is communal, but I never noticed or thought about the word "no need for greed or hunger." Mm-hmm. That rejects the nature of man, because even if you put everything on the same playing field, if we're all equal, you haven't eliminated greed. Right. There's still a sin right. nature that we're going to want more. I want more than Alex has.
You know? Well, imagine no possessions.
It does reflect when he got involved in the Eastern religions.
Yeah.
He's very
yeah.
reflective of that.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, how about...
What's interesting, though, if you forget who said everything else and just took the principles of it...
Yeah.
If we actually had a world that followed our Bible and the teachings in it, would it not have a feel more of the communal? I mean, you know, and that's... There is going to be a time after Christ's return, and we get to that point that this will actually work, because
so,
it,
hold on,
because that greed part, when it's all over, yeah, I'm talking after 1,000 years, the whole bit, there will be a point where there won't be greed, and there won't be any of the striving.
Okay, fine. At least define your time frames.
Well, George has thoughts on this.
Yeah, I agree, actually. I think he's longing for the kingdom. He doesn't know what it is, but he's longing for the kingdom of God on earth. May God's kingdom come. It's what we all want.
Yeah.
And he knew it, but he didn't know how to get it.
He's writing about Hare Krishna.
Yeah, and Marxism.
No, that's true.
And all of
this. It's all Hare Krishna teachings.
But you can change the words a little bit.
And George, actually, Steve, are you posting that?
I haven't. I mean, I can't.
George wrote his own words.
Awesome.
Read it, George.
Imagine seeing it.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks. I've been there, done that.
You can do it.
Imagine heaven on earth. It's easy if you try. No Hades below us, above us only sky. Imagine all the people living for Jesus Christ. Mm. The next, you can go on the next verse works without changing anything. The no religion, there won't be religion. We'll all know God. We don't need to teach each other.
Yeah.
He'll be living with us. And then the chorus is, you may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope you all believe in Jesus, and the world will be as one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which is what will happen in the kingdom. Imagine no deception. I wonder if you can. No greed or envy, a brotherhood of man. Imagine all the people sharing all the world. And there you go.
During the millennial kingdom, just crops will grow so fast you barely have time to plant them and then bring them up. Okay. This is the last song. This is a grunge musician, Elliot Smith. Let me go back up. Start over.
Was it written by a Canadian?
No, it's a cat.
He was British. He was British.
He was born in Omaha. No, he really was. Raised in Texas and lived in Portland. Oh, wrong guy. I hit the wrong word. So I was right, and he's just giving me grief. His real name was Stephen Paul Smith. He just went by Elliot Smith. Born in Omaha, raised in Texas, and then after he was, and then lived in Portland, Oregon as an adult. He died at 34.
No, that's the wrong Elliot Smith. Died in 34.
Or no.
Died
You can see kind of the nihilistic. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is a downer. It's talking about, you know, taking drugs and dying, and nothing means anything.
It's like totally. And he was considered indie folk, not grunge. Yeah. Just mess with Scott. Sorry.
He did wear the funny hat.
Yes, he was weird.
So anyway, you can kind of see where a lot of this modern thought is in these songs, and you can listen and not be listening. So as Sarah's worldview teacher said, live with your brain turned on. You can go along and not be thinking. And so we want to think. But I do want to leave us as we clean up the room with something more uplifting. And so we'll have the birds.
Good job, Scott. That was very interesting.
We spent a bit of thought. We won't be able to listen to the radio the same anymore. I'm going to go to the next one.